Thank you very much. I must thank the organizing committee for giving me the opportunity to present my work before such distinguished audience. So I'm a postdoctoral fellow in Christopher Sassetti's lab in University of Massachusetts Medical School. So what I'm going to talk today is one of the most unappreciated role of nitric oxide in regulating immunopathology during tuberculosis infection. So as we all know, that TB disease has diverse outcome. Majority of the individuals who are infected with TB, they can control the infection very well. And most of them, they remain asymptomatic for years or decades or sometimes lifelong. They have a good T cell response to various TB antigens, and they never develop tissue damage or barely minimal tissue damage. Whereas few unfortunate individuals, they develop the active TB disease, which is marked by extensive damage to their tissue architecture, and they could not mount a potent T cell response to the antigens, and that's the reason of the major mortality due to TB disease. The major question that still remains unanswered in the TB research field is how tissue damage is controlled during TB in majority of the asymptomatic asymptomatic individuals or latently infected individuals. To understand that, we took advantage of the mouse model of TB infection. So from the literature, it's known that a mouse which can induce a potent T cell response, the bacteria grows uninhibited for first 3 weeks. And once the adaptive immunity or the T cell response kicks in, the bacterial number is maintained at a constant level. And in this situation, the host survives without developing any tissue damage. But on the contrary, the mouse strains which lack T cells, either genetically deficient or if they have an impaired T cell response, the bacteria grows uninhibited, and the host die prematurely owing to extensive tissue damage. Not only when the presence of T cells dictate this disease, but if you look at the cellular infiltration in the presence of T cells, the neutrophils first comes in, and once the T cell response starts, the neutrophil numbers goes down drastically. Whereas in the absence of T cells, the neutrophils are persistently elevated in the lungs. And neutrophils, though they are essential for controlling TB, they are the potential source of proteolytic enzymes and reactive oxygen intermediates, so they can cause inadvertent damage to the host tissue. So based on that, we hypothesize that adaptive immunity. So here onwards, I'll focus on T cell response as the adaptive immunity. So adaptive immunity can control the bacterial growth, which we all know, and it can also control the tissue damage. The host must control bacterial growth as well as tissue damage to survive a chronic infection such as TB. So to address this hypothesis, we infected different mouse strains lacking T cells or lacking T cell derived interferon gamma or the nitric oxide synthase, and with tuberculosis, and we found that all these mouse strains which lack the different arms of T cell response, they develop extensive damage to their lungs, and they succumb to infection quite rapidly. And when we look at the cellular infiltrates in the airways, we found that this interferon gamma knockout, RAG knockout, as well as the iNOS knockout mice, they have more neutrophils as compared to the wild type controls. So we conclude that T cells can control neutrophil influx during TB infection, at least in the mouse model. Then we asked whether the tissue damage we observed in this T cell defective mouse, whether it's because of the inadequate control of the bacterial numbers, or is it because of the over exuberant immune response, the host immune response. For that, we probed the lung milieu for different cytokines and chemokines. And we found that all these knockout mouse strains, they have a typical cytokine signature, predominantly IL-1 driven chemokines and cytokines, such as MIP-1 alpha, MIP-1 beta, and monocyte chemoattractant protein MCP-1. And these chemokines and cytokines, they have been known to induce neutrophilic infiltration in various models. So as we all know that T cells can produce interferon gamma and can induce nitric oxide synthase in antigen-presenting cells or different phagocytes. And that can produce nitric oxide. So nitric oxide being the proximal mediator of this T cell response, we hypothesize that probably nitric oxide might regulate IL-1 or IL-1 mediated neutrophilic inflammation. But we all know that nitric oxide has an antimicrobial function. And in agreement with this, we found that the nitric oxide synthase knockout mice, they have 100-fold more bacteria than the wild-type controls. So in order to dissociate the putative anti-inflammatory or the immunoregulatory function of nitric oxide from the antibacterial function, we need a situation wherein the INOS knockout mice or the nitric oxide synthase knockout mice should have equal bacterial numbers or almost equivalent bacterial numbers with the wild type. So in this kind of situation, we can address whether the nitric oxide possesses any anti-inflammatory function. So to accomplish this, we took advantage of a mouse model wherein we use a tuberculosis strain that depends on streptomycin for its growth. It's called the MTB18B. So we infected this mouse strain and give the mouse with streptomycin so that bacteria will replicate. And after a couple of weeks, when the adaptive immune response kicks in, we withdraw streptomycin from the animals. And then, so in the absence of streptomycin, bacteria will survive but do not grow. So, and then we determine CFU and other disease parameters to understand the disease conditions. So using this model, we could achieve equivalent bacterial numbers in the spleen as well as in the lungs. So in this situation, then we asked whether the nitric oxide synthase knockout mice, whether they have a different disease as compared to the wild-type mice. And to our surprise, we found that nitric oxide synthase knockout mice, even if can have the same bacterial numbers, they still have worse disease. They still have necrosis and they succumb to infection very quickly. So we conclude that nitric oxide can inhibit tissue damage. And then we measure the IL-1 beta in this condition, and we found that INOS knockout mice has more IL-1 beta as compared to the wild type. So we conclude that nitric oxide can also block IL-1. And then we measured the neutrophil infiltration into the lungs in the dissociated lung tissue as well as in the airways as a measure of tissue damage. And we found that nitric oxide synthase knockout mice has more neutrophils and also the lung homogenates have more myeloperoxidase activity, which is a key neutrophil enzyme. So we conclude from this data that nitric oxide can also block neutrophilic infiltration. Then we wanted to understand that whether the nitric oxide mediated inhibition of IL-1 and neutrophil infiltration can cause tissue damage, or whether the tissue pathology we observed in nitric oxide synthase knockout mice is because of IL-1 driven neutrophilic infiltration. So before that, I move further into the mechanistic part, I just want to introduce the IL-1 beta system. So I hope many of you know about IL-1 beta, which is a potent inflammatory cytokine. So during TB infection, the MTB factors, then they can stimulate the TLRs. and then TLR stimulation lead to NF kappa B activation and the pro form of the cytokine synthesis. And there are other factors from MTB. They can induce cytosolic protein complex called the inflammasome that has NAP3 and an adapter protein called ASK and pro-caspase 1. And once this complex is formed, it can activate the caspase 1, which is a cysteine protease, and caspase 1 is required for maturing the pro-IL-1 beta into its mature form. So once the pro-IL-1 beta is matured by the caspase 1, it's immediately secreted out, and it can function in autocrine or in a paracrine fashion through IL-1 receptor signaling to induce a plethora of effects such as neutrophil pathology. So to understand the role of IL-1 receptor as well as the contribution of inflammasome, we used the streptomycin-dependent model. And we depleted nitric oxide synthase from these mice using a nitric oxide synthase inhibitor called aminoguanidine. And using our model, we determined the neutrophil infiltration as well as MPO activity in the lungs in this mouse model. And we found that nitric oxide regulates IL-1 dependent neutrophil influx in this aminoguanidine treated mice. And the neutrophil influx was entirely dependent on IL-1 receptor. And in addition, we also found that the ASK deficient mice, when they are treated with aminoguanidine, the neutrophil infiltration, the myeloperoxidase activity in the lungs was drastically goes down. That implies that inflammasome dependent IL-1 is required in this model for neutrophil mediated pathology. So then we wanted to understand the mechanism of IL-1 suppression by nitric oxide. So in order to understand that, we developed an in vitro model wherein we stimulated bone marrow derived macrophages with different TLRs and then infected them with TB and measured IL-1 beta. So we found that when we infected macrophages with TB, we found a good amount of IL-1 beta, but upon interferon gamma treatment, the IL-1 beta production was drastically reduced. But when the macrophages lacked nitric oxide synthase, the IL-1 beta suppression was completely relieved. So it was completely reconstituted. And this was at the level of the secretion. And there was no change with the at the level of synthesis of the IL-1 beta. So we conclude that interferon gamma mediated nitric oxide can block IL-1 beta. And then we wanted to further understand that what is the mechanism of this suppression. So nitric oxide can activate guanylate cyclase to produce cyclic GMP. So we added cyclic GMP into bacterial cell culture, and we didn't find any effect. And then we checked the transcription level of pro-IL-1 beta and pro-caspase, and we didn't find any effect. So we exclude this arm of nitric oxide-mediated IL-1 beta inhibition. And the next question we asked that whether nitric oxide can post-translationally modify inflammasome components. So nitric oxide is known to modulate proteins through a post-translational modification called S-nitrosylation. So we asked whether relevant inflammasome proteins are nitrosylated, and whether the nitrosylation of these proteins can lead to an inhibition of the assembly or activity of the inflammasome, and whether we can restore the activity of inflammasome through reversal of nitrosylation. And we found that nitric oxide induces nitrosylation of NAL3 and caspase 1, and it inhibits assembly of NAL3 inflammasome, and also by treating cells with ascorbate, which is a reductant that can reverse, that can denitrosylate nitrosylated proteins, we can reverse the we can reconstitute the production of IL-1 beta in a dose-dependent fashion. So the model will be that disease can be determined by the pro-inflammatory mediators such as IL-1 beta and the bacterial numbers. When there is more bacteria, the host can die. When there is more inflammatory mediators, the host can die. So the host must control the optimal level of the pro-inflammatory mediators as well as the bacterial numbers. So there are other anti-inflammatory arms, arms of a host that can control the tissue damage. So to that, we added that interferon gamma mediated IL-1 beta suppression can also regulate tissue damage, at least in a mouse model. So so with that, I conclude my presentation. So I must thank my lab members. They're excellent people. And Fitzgerald Lab for all the inflammasome studies. Antonio Campos Neto for providing us the streptomycin-dependent strain. And last but not the least, my mentor, Dr. Christopher Sassetti, for being the best mentor in the world.